Good morning, my name is Svenja Knappe and I'm Associate Research Professor at the University of Colorado and a co-founder of Fieldline. And today I want to talk to you about an uncooled sensor technology called OPMs that could bring advantages to MEG. Here on the right is a photo of my colleague Matti Hämäläinen with a helmet that has a bunch of these OPM sensors mounted to them. And why I want to show you this photo up front is because it can give you a good idea where the technology is at right now. There's still a fair amount of tape and cardboard in this, but the sensors are available, they're used in first MEG measurements, and I think it is a really exciting state. So after an introduction into OPMs, I will talk about the advantages that they can bring for neuroscientists, the power of MEMS to make those sensors, and then current challenges, what we need to do to make a full OPM MEG system, and then where can we go in the future. OPM stands for optically pumped magnetometer, and they're based on a vapor of atoms, in our case, rubidium atoms. And you can use polarized light to transfer the spin of the light to orient the spins of the atoms in the gas phase by absorbing these photons. And so we can align the electron spins in the vapor, and then in a magnetic field, the electron spins will start precessing at a well-defined frequency called the Lamo frequency. And so that balance of pumping and precession causes a static repolarization. So the average spin of that vapor will point into a different direction. And we can read out what that direction is by the amount of light that passes through the cell. Because when it's all the way aligned, no more angular momentum can be transferred, so the cell becomes transparent. While if it is tipped to a certain angle, more light passes because we can realign more atoms. And so we can make these sensors, and people in the community have made magnetic field sensors based on that that are rivaling the best squid with sensitivities way under a femtotesla per terahertz. And that's really exciting to do with a technology that has not to be immersed in liquid helium. And what that means for MEG kind of shows this study by my colleagues from Boston, where they simulated the localization error as a function of current density, so strength of the dipole, for a variety of different systems. The first one here is a system where we use these OPMs and we place them directly onto the scalp of the person compared to EEG, that's also known scalp technology, compared to a standard MEG system, and then to one, a squid-based MEG system that's specifically made for five-year-old kids. And what you can see is that here, this is a study for a newborn, particularly the localization error remains very low when you can use these on-scalp OPMs as compared to the other technologies where the sensors are usually much further away from the head. Similar results have been found in a variety of other studies since then, but all of these studies conclude that with an OPM-based system and sensitivities around 10 femtotesla per hertz, which is realistic, you can reach much higher signal power, much higher information capacity, much lower minimum norm spread functions when you move these sensors directly on the scalp. And that is exciting. There's several other things that that also come with this uncooled on-scalp technology. And it's really good news for all of us who have non-standard heads that you can reach these good performance no matter what your head shape or size is. Particularly interesting in the study for children that tend to have smaller heads, that tend to move around. Now the sensors move with the subject, so movement can be allowed to a certain degree, you can think about sleep studies that maybe lead to long-term telemetry or be able to move around for brain-computer interface studies. You can think about new paradigms because you can study much more natural environments. In the current system, you're asked to stick your head in there, not move, but relax and act naturally. And that's just really hard. And so if you could define new paradigms that take advantage of this possibility to have much more natural movements, those can open new studies and new insights. Social interaction studies can benefit because you could put the system on several people while they're interacting with each other in the same room. Because you don't need cryogenics, it could also lead for less expensive systems that can operate in much smaller rooms, in maybe person-sized shields. And you can think about putting them on mobile units where now you can bring the system to the patient rather than the other way around. So you can see there's a long list of possibilities that could really enable new studies and new science. In order to make that happen, we have to build a lot of these. We have to put several hundred or hundreds of magnetometers onto the head of a person. And so our implementation is heavily driven by simplicity. So we have our small vapor cell, and we even use a single laser beam that is polarized circularly to both probe the atoms and pump the atoms simultaneously and just detect the transmitted light. And in order to build, and this is kind of what we measure, and I showed this before, but in order to build a directional magnetometer out of that, we add a field modulation with small coils in a direction transverse to the laser beam. And then if we demodulate that detector signal at that frequency, we make our magnetometer sensitive to the magnetic field projection in that direction. And we also get this really nice and steep zero crossing here. And we don't just need to do this in one direction, we can do it in two or three simultaneously and get those directions as well. We want to be this slope to be as steep as possible. So we operate in a regime where collisional broadening due to spin exchange is suppressed, but it requires high vapor densities, so high cell temperatures and very low magnetic fields. So we do currently need to work in a shielded environment, and we need to add compensation coils to compensate out those ambient fields. And then in order to remain at this steep zero crossing, we operate in what we call closed loop regime, where we feed back the signal to the modulation coils to make sure we're always staying right here on the zero crossing. In order to make these, again, we want to make lots of these. We want to make them with high uniformity, manufacturable. And so we're heavily relying on MEMS fabrication technologies to do that. Conventionally, these atoms are confined in these glass cells. That's hard to miniaturize with high uniformity, and it's not really a parallel process. So we've developed silicon and glass technologies on wafers to make these cells here, and we can make them in a variety of shapes and sizes. And similarly, we have to heat these cells really high. We do that with small micro heaters, but we also want to bring this cell that's now at 150 degrees really close to our subject. And so we need to develop really good thermal isolation procedures, approaches. And so traditionally, we've 3D printed these enclosures, and we have gone to developing MEMS vacuum packages, MEMS packaging approaches. This particular one is inspired by the Draper Labs, to, again, make these in parallel fabrication method, with parallel fabrication methods, and reduce the standoff distance and the thermal transfer of heat from our vapor cell here in the center to the outside where the subject is. We've made many sensor systems based on that. This one here is one I like because it has implemented gradiometers. We have two of these vacuum packages, one here and then one 2 centimeters further back. So a gradiometer with a baseline of 2 centimeters. And we have built 22 of these gradiometers. And on the left here, you can see the average sensitivity when we average all those together is somewhere between 10 and 15 femtotesla per root hertz. That's the gradiometer sensitivity. So the intrinsic magnetometer sensitivity is squared of 2 better than that. But we can't measure that because when you look at the magnetometers here in blue, all you see is vibration noise, common noise from the background, and so on. But all of that gets suppressed out with the gradiometer. We can then use that to record brain signals. And here on the left, this is a paradigm that's been our workhorse paradigm for the last 12 years, trying to cross-validate these sensors with squid MEG systems. This is somatosensory evoked responses. And you can see that signal amplitudes are rather large. They're kind of in the picotesla range. And then we can use that to localize where that brain activity came from. And a variety of paradigms have been run. This is just one of them. The second class of experiments are resting state experiments here on the right, just alpha wave standard experiments where the subject is asked to open and close their eyes every 20 or 30 seconds. And here you can see in the frequency time spectrum on the bottom that when the subject closes their eyes, you see this really strong alpha response around 10 hertz, but the signals are so strong that you can even see higher harmonics of this. So we've built these systems in research. We've built them with over 100 channels, but we realized fairly soon that this is not the way to bring it to the users to build them at a university as a research system. And so we founded a small company, my co-founders Rangalam and Jeremy Hughes and I, and we looked at our research systems and yes, we can operate 100 COM ports, but it's just not the way to go if you want to make a commercially reliable system. So we turned it upside down. We started from the ground up to build a multi-channel system specifically for MEG. And see on the top right, you can see our sensors. The footprint is 13 by 15 millimeters. Sensitivities are somewhere under 10 femtotesla per root hertz, and we've worked really hard on the consistency. And here you can see several sensors on the bottom. This is the response, and you can see the bandwidths are around 175 hertz, and we can make these sensors really consistently. And we have shipped many of these systems to neuroscientists in all over the world, and we're working very closely with them to develop them further. And add the things into a full OPM MEG system that is needed for neuroscience experiments. There are many challenges that still have to be addressed that we have addressed that we're working on the technology as well. And so some of them are linearity, scale factor stability, how often do you have to recalibrate them, common mode rejection of the gradiometers, cross-axis sensitivity. And we found that most of these we can solve by working in this closed loop environment so that your scale factor stability is not determined by your environment anymore, but is fixed. And we've managed to reach much higher common mode rejection with that and much lower cross-axis sensitivity. The challenge that comes with closed loop operation is crosstalk, because now your signal is on the feedback coil, and so the neighbor could see that. And so we worked on designs to reduce that, and we can now reach crosstalks under 2%, even at the lowest packing densities. Other challenges are to know where those sensors are. They're different. It's different for every subject. And finally, we also need to work on better source models. As we get these sensors much closer to the scalp, we can see a lot more things that might that our far field approaches might not take care of. So we have to work very closely in all these different disciplines to actually so that we can actually demonstrate those higher localization accuracies that were promised theoretically, and build systems that are very well characterized and stable. And that's really the push right now. To push this technology even further, we can try to go smaller. Here on the left, you can see that we can already make OPMs the size of EEG electrodes, and we've used them to measure epileptiform activity in rats. But we can go even smaller to make pixel sizes of a few tens of microns and try to make magnetographic cameras that can capture that activity over larger areas. Here are three other applications that could benefit from these sensors: magnetoelectrometry of functionalized magnetic nanoparticles, nuclear magnetic resonance for chemical analysis or imaging, and then combining these OPMs with other stimulation technologies, such as multi-channel TMS here on the right. And these are other exciting avenues that can really broaden the applicability of these sensors for neuroscience experiments. So let me quickly summarize. OPMs are here to stay. They open a variety of possibilities for neuroscience research, but there's still technical challenges that have to be used. And it's absolutely critical that we translate this and make them commercially available, and then work with neuroscientists to make this technology real OPM MEG systems. I want to recognize all my colleagues at CU Fieldline, as well as our collaborators, and of course the funding from NIH. Thank you. Please, I'm open for questions, but send me emails if you want to talk to me about any of what I presented today. Thank you.